Well, wonderful to have Reinhold Leinfelder here for our first Tuesday discussion with environmental experts here at the Rachel Carson Center. Reinhold Leinfelder is well known to us at the Carson Center, so we know a little bit of his story. We know that he really wanted to be a forester at one point and save the rainforest and a biologist until he realized that you had to cut up frog bellies. But he became a geologist and was interested in volcanology because that lets you travel around the globe. Reinhold Leinfelder was a professor of geology. I think he was one of the youngest professors of geology in Germany, in Stuttgart, became a professor in Munich at one point in geology and earth history a long time ago. And then he became the director general of natural history collections in Munich. He moved to Berlin, became the founding director of the Futurium, the house of the future that was imagining different scenarios for the future. He's been an advisor to the German government on environmental change. And I can go on and on about this. You realize he's a big shot and he shuts me up. But I really want to tell you that he is not only an important scientist who's worked on coral reefs, and figured out, for instance, that coral reefs, the way we look at them today, the ones that we see today are very different from the ones that we used to have. So they don't serve well as a model. But he's also a great science communicator. He's been involved he's produced some wonderful comics. The most important thing, however, for us is that 10 years ago, Reinhold Leinfelder was a fellow at the Rachel Carson Center. And at that time, we met in a very little castle with a moat, a water castle, for 3 days. And in these 3 days, the fellows and the staff of the Carson Center were thinking about what shall we do? We have money for a big exhibition at the Deutsches Museum. There were all sorts of ideas coming up, natural catastrophes, land use, and Reinhold Leinfelder said, why don't you do the Anthropocene? And out of it came the Welcome to the Anthropocene exhibition at the Deutsches Museum of the Carson Center. And one of the people who was involved is also with us today, Nina Möllers, and several others have visited that wonderful exhibition. So Reinhold, you've been very important, more than you may know, for us. And today, Reinhold is talking about, like each time in our Tuesday discussion, we want people to introduce an institution. Today, it's the Anthropocene Working Group, an interdisciplinary and international group to which people like Paul Crutzen, until recently, belonged, the Nobel Prize laureate. And we can't wait. We can't wait to hear from Reinhold Leinfelder. We look forward to your 10-minute presentation.
Thank you, Christoph. Thank you for the introduction. I'm so blushing that I don't know whether I can. I'm so pampered, don't know whether I can even talk properly. But I'm really glad that I'm here. And, well, I'm trying to do a tour de force through the Anthropocene under the focus of the Anthropocene Working Group. I'm sure you are quite familiar with the basic concepts and different things here. So this is a kind of maybe a science slam in 10 minutes so that we have enough time for discussion. So I'll just start with my short presentation. And what you see here is already the logo for the Welcome to the Anthropocene exhibition, which we did, the Rachel Carson Center and Deutsche Museum exhibition, which we did at that time here. So you've heard already of Paul Crutzen, who is not only a Nobel laureate and unfortunately who just passed away quite recently, end of January, but he's also known as the father of the Anthropocene, if I may say so, because it was in the year 2000 where he just got up in a meeting of the Earth system scientists, those who just collected again what all humankind did to the Earth system again. And he got up, and you know this certainly, they said, he was almost fumbling for words, and he said, we don't live in the Holocene anymore, we live in the Anthropocene. And here was the word. Some others had used it already, and so, but which he didn't know here, but he said much more than this word with this, because he meant that we should cut off something here of the Holocene and have a new era here, a new epoch of the Earth history table here. But he said more with that here. In principle, it was that he just came up with three hypotheses. He said the Earth system is different to what we used to have here. So we are... humankind has become an Earth system factor. And then the fact that he used that word Anthropocene, like just in like following what you have all here, Eocene, Oligocene, and so forth, Pleistocene, Holocene. So a geological term, a stratigraphic term. So he also said and meant and wrote it up then down in a newsletter and later on in Nature that humankind has also become a geological factor, that the effects of this Earth system changes, the like a hypothesis he formulated it, is an imprint which remains and which characterizes a new Earth, a new sediments, and maybe also a new epoch here. But he didn't stop at that. With that also, he added it in the newsletter, I believe it was, he added and said, politicians won't fix that. We need also sciences, humanities, technology, and so forth here, the third hypothesis. So I like these three statements which he made here, and I just briefly, just very rapidly browse through this here. So that's what I always say, the complex Anthropocene concept has an Earth system level, it has a geological or stratigraphic level, and it has a kind of a consequential meta level or responsibility level. You know a lot of the Earth system level, I'm sure, and I can't go into details here in this long list. If you feel like we can discuss some of these aspects here, let me just point out two things here, like what you see all in black here is not nature, not pristine nature anymore here. About 3/4 of the ice-free land surface is not pristine anymore, and it's not different in the seas. And maybe then later on I will speak a little bit about this technosphere and maybe a bit of the energy usage. So these are quantities, overwhelming quantities. A lot has happened. The next thing in this Earth system aspect is that we don't only have the problems and not only the interactions and the mutual interaction of the problems, but we also have the temporal dynamics, the great acceleration since about the mid of the 20th century, where the socioeconomic trends like GDP or fertilizer consumption, you name it, just not only coincides, but causes all this Earth system trends rapidly going up there. And then the question is, of course, how do they interact and are there tipping points? And you know that tipping point research is a very big thing here. And I just coming with this last slide for the Earth system here. So we used to be in the Holocene range of environmental stability with all some shifts here. We left this around 1950. Present, we are somewhere here. And this is how the warmest episode during the Quaternary, which we know quite well how the climate system worked and this and that. And the big question is whether by steering the Earth system or helping to develop the Earth system into a positive way for us, can we remain somewhere in here 1.5, 2 degrees, or we are just jumping up into something which we only know from greenhouse scenarios. Millions, tens of million years ago here. A brief look at the stratigraphy level, the geology level here. So there are a lot of different ideas where the Anthropocene could start here. Some say we have to do certainly with the extinction of the megafauna when we started just hunting with spears and things like that. This is controversial, and it has a negative, something is missing. It doesn't have a positive indicator here, but it's an important thing to discuss. And then, of course, many say it's the Neolithic revolution that we really started heavily changing, altering the Earth, and especially also the biosphere. And yes, this was a really important, and it's really important to understand this well, but it was through thousands of years and it was regional, and it was not a really sharp break. There's another idea, I'm not going into details for this here, but then there was Paul Crewson initially who said, well, at the end of the 18th century, like when the steam engine was becoming more perfect by the work of James Watts, that would be the idea maybe. So the acceleration of the industrialization. Later on, he agreed with us, and I'm coming to that us in a minute, that the mid 20th century might be a better option. But all this is important work here, and I just scribbled this once. I don't know for what reason. So if this is a sharp line, and we think this is a very sharp line where we have a chronostratigraphic, a chronological level which we can cross, can trace across the globe. So this might be like the suggestion of the Anthropocene, but this is the way to the Anthropocene. This is a pre or a proto Anthropocene, or call it archaeosphere. So where you have a lot of changes and it goes to and fro, and sometimes you have already high cultures where others are still living in the woods here. So just having a look at this chronostratigraphic chart, which is not, some say it's the Bible of geology, but it's just a best practice thing done by the International Commission on Stratigraphy, so that we know when I speak about the Upper Jurassic that the colleague in Brazil and the other one in China understands the same thing of it. And if we are sure, or if these commissions which are there are sure, then something, it's really nailed in. We call it really a golden spike. And you see, not everywhere there are these golden spikes, like in the Upper Jurassic, for instance, but in the Holocene, in the meantime, there are these golden spikes. But the Anthropocene, you don't see yet inside. So who is we? We is the Anthropocene Working Group, which is just a working group under the commission, under the International Commission on Stratigraphy. They have a lot of sub-commissions. There's a sub-commission on the Quaternary, and this is a big body of the IUGS, which is the International Union of Geosciences. And what is new? So these working groups, they should test an idea, should say, is this a good idea? Should we really define an Anthropocene? And if so, where should it start? And what is like the typus area, like things like that, where we can put in that that golden spike and how we can trace it across the globe. So you see, this is already quite interdisciplinary. There are about 20, broadly saying, geologists, but many very interdisciplinary colleagues in there. There's archaeology, there is environmental history, very important names, John McNeil, for instance, and so on. There's agriculture, even environmental laws, and so forth. And now this I have to reduce to, this is Earth System Sciences to 18, because Paul has left us here. So, and this is what we say, where we suggest that a lower boundary of the Anthropocene should be positioned is in the mid of 20th century, where everything goes up, what we find also in the earth here, like concrete, elementary aluminium, which otherwise you don't have in nature. You see here 98% is produced since 1950. Plastics just started during and after World War II going up like hell. There is industrial fly ash. There is radioactive fallout. And now all this, what we have also in other parts of the quaternary, anomalies in ice cores and things like, and in skeletons, coral skeletons and things like that. So, and we can even go further. Now, if you look like plastic, you find that plastic accumulating from the mid 20th century, 1950s or so, but you can even be more precise and use it like for a microstratigraphy, as I want to call it here. And if you compare this, say, with a fine stratigraphy of done by ammonites in the Jurassic, say, for in southern Germany or so, where this example is from, it's quite similar here. And we are also testing this at the very moment. So what we are doing now is, yes, we are really convinced that we should, that the Anthropocene should start in the mid 20th century. And we are going through all this environmental areas, sedimentary areas here, and we check whether we have sufficient geosignals, technofossils, we even call it. You see them highlighted here around the mid 20th century. And that's the thing. And I can tell you much more how the whole thing works later on in the discussion if you're interested. So this is just one on this last part on this, well, consequential meta level. And this is just from our latest paper, which is open access, which you can load down here. And you see, we really are sure that this, all this work on the Anthropocene, all the different meanings and all sometimes also different words even. And this all is important for not only defining the Anthropocene, but for understanding the Anthropocene, of course, and for telling the Anthropocene, and for coming up with solutions how we could continue here. And you see, and even for the Earth system and the geology and paleontology, we do cooperate a lot. You saw it in that list before with other subjects here and with soil sciences, sciences and so forth. And of course, here we need historians, and especially to find out why it happened, who was it, and how we could continue all about these aspects here. I think when we consider this consequential meter level, we really have a huge concept here, and we are reaching out the hands for more discussion and more cooperation, because this is what the Anthropocene really is. And now, since you saw this in my background, I have to also explain this here. This is what we call the technosphere, and what I mean with that here. And I mean, we're taking out like non-renewable materials from the lithosphere and put them together to build up houses and other things and pieces like cars, like the computer I'm speaking to, and like many, many other things which you see here. By the way, this is the cover of a book which was accompanying the Anthropocene exhibition of the Rachel Carson Center in the Deutsche Museum. So maybe you came across a recent paper, not from our group, El Hasham and others, and they came up with that these technomaterials, they amount to 1 trillion metric tons, but this is only the material which is currently still in use here. And they said, okay, this is now surpassing the living biomass. They compared it with thrivate. This is from the Baron group. It's the same group here, and depends a little bit on whether you make it carbon-based or wet weight or whatever. But so this was similar. But the thing is, if we also consider what we have to, in addition, extract just to get out a little bit of gold or many, many other things, it's 7 times as much here. So that's 7 teratons already. And we tried then to just make a scientific guess on this total technosphere. That means everything what humans have already altered or moved, at least something like this, and this amounts to 30 trillion tons here. So these are huge masses. And if we compare this here, so that would mean that what we produce there would be 50 kilograms per square meter on the entire globe, whether it's oceans or mainland here. And so, and we, each of us, although we are so many, we would have 7 soccer fields if we distribute it equally here. So that is the technosphere. And of course, to produce this technosphere and to use this technosphere, we need all these fossil fuels, at least mostly fossil fuels. So, and if you consider the GHG emissions, like more or less, that means like 1/3 we need for putting up our raw houses, like they're like our recent caves here, and for feeding ourselves with all tricks how we do it nowadays. The other third, second third, we need for extracting and putting together all the other machineries, all the other appliances we use. And the last third, we need to make them move. They work for us, but they only do it when they get to eat, if you want. So they are also really, really, really hungry. And we tried in another paper, came out end of last year, we tried to also measure this somehow here. So we came up with numbers. These are zetajoules, just to get an idea of the differences here. So in the whole Holocene, about 12,000 years, this amounted to this sum here. But in the last 70 years, we used 1.5 times more energy than in the 12,000 years before. So these are just very, very rough numbers, but it gives you an impression of what we are really doing and where is the major problem here. And we can go further if we, now this is kind of a metabolism of the Anthropocene, of the technosphere. We can go further, and we did this also in the exhibition. Biodiversity is very diverse. Here you see a couple of numbers. Technodiversity, even a rougher guess, but could sort of be of the same thing. And of course, now what's missing is that the techno sphere would work like the biosphere, using renewables like sunlight, others, and we would have a circular economy, circular, so that the things would be always in use and there would be not a major problem. Okay, so there I would go a bit deeper. I'm coming to the end, sorry. So I really think we have to rethink sustainability in a more integrative, in a more systemic context. This was good. This was Brundtland Commission, but still these different sectors of sustainability, social, ecological, economical, hoping that there's a huge overlap, which in real life isn't. So this is from, I think, John Rockström used this the first time. So when it comes to the real life, so it's always in favor of the economy, and this is marginalized here. And if I can be a bit more blunt even, I would say it, even in our world, of we speak of the Umwelt, which means that, yes, we like the environment, but it's somewhere, it's too far away from us here. We live here in this bubble, in this economical bubble, and maybe, you know, this is really mean, maybe we are just a mitochondrium just to move, keep this bubble going on here. But, and we like to go to the environment. It surrounds us, but in a remote area, and we might enjoy it, make holidays there, or we might say, yes, we should do something, but then we go back here and it's not part of us, not really part of us. It's even in the name, even in English, the environs, the surroundings or something like this. So we really would need something different. I once came up with the word Unswelt, which would be us world. Doesn't mean that the world belongs to us, but it means that we are a part of, we should behave like an integrative part of it, with economy, certainly very central, but it has to be embedded in social and cultural sphere. And this all has to be embedded in an earth system that can carry us forever, or for very, very, very many future generations. This is the problem. So just one conclusion here. That's another point I would like to make here, especially here in the Western world here. We know that we have to change, but then we like to discuss for years and tens of years, what is the one right pathway into the future here. So it's either good or bad, it's right or wrong, it's heaven or hell or something like that here. Instead of saying, yes, we have quite some possibilities, like reactive pathways, sufficiency pathways, like circular economy, bioadaptive pathways, high-tech pathways. And of course, we should always have portfolios like this. And if we have something like the example of the biosphere and something like a compass to a circular economy, I think that can lead us, but we should start now. And that is really what the Anthropocene, I think, also teaches us, that integrative view. Thank you very much. Here are a couple of books here. This was the last, this is a couple of comics, and this is the last one we did with the whole Anthropocene working group, which might be of some interest. It is a Karlsburger Cambridge University Press. But many thanks for your interest.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Reinhold.